DTM Devina Chaturvedi, developing unforgettable characters, developing unforgettable characters, Devina Chaturvedi.
Today. I am no authority on the subject, but I still put it out there that this is a topic which has been pretty much well rehearsed by me. I say pretty much because there's too much knowledge out there and it's not possible to gather all of it in such a short time, which is just 23 years of life. So we follow a specific path as we go down the session today. So first I'll basically talk about the characters and what their graph is, because that plays a major role in how you will develop a character for your story. Then we talk about the three dimensions in which all characters operate, and finally we'll get into the writing bits of it and how you can write a character for your story, whatever that might be. But before we jump into any of that, I have an activity. For that I need two volunteers. Can I have any two volunteers on the stage right now? Come up, Aditya. One more. Want to volunteer? Come on up. Let's have a huge round. You will be playing the role of yourself. So the character is you yourself. And what I require you to do is be in the Delhi metro. So let's say MT is already in the metro and Aditya is going to enter at Rajiv Chowk metro station. This is the yellow line going towards Vishwavidyalaya.
I have a seat or
not? Alright, so the duration for this activity is 1.5 minutes and the time starts when I say it starts. Starts now.
What are you doing?
Space? Space? Need some space.
I don't see in that. I have not thought you in that way.
Neither am I. But you can try.
I don't want to try.
Anyway, where are you off to?
I am off to off you.
Not a good place to be. Which one is mine?
So, whatever it is, I am going on.
Alright, thank you. Now take your seats comfortably, so. Alright, so what I want you to notice about the activity that we just did. A, did it feel like they were in a metro?
Yes.
B, if you were in that situation, would you do the same thing? C, if it were a real metro, is this how the two of them would have reacted? Exactly. So your character was way far away from reality. Nobody does that in a metro. Right? That's one of the key things that you have to remember. Whenever we're developing a character, we're not doing a caricature. Your characters can be as real to life as you are. What do? When you enter a metro? You go, you look for a place you don't find when you stand. You probably listen to music or read something, you text. Right? You don't go around talking to strangers. So that's one thing that if you take back nothing else from my talk today, take back this. Keep your characters real. Jumping on now to the characters' graphs that we have. So there are broadly two kind of characters that we have based on the arc or the graph that they follow. First are those which go in a straight line, in the sense that the character does not really change. So somebody like Sherlock or, well, if I may say Tony Stark, he changed at the very end, but then overall, they kind of remain constant. Now, again, within that category, there are two subcategories. There are those whose graph remains flat. They do not change because they can't help themselves. That's just who they are. And then there are those who have an increasing graph in the sense that they don't change, but everything around them changes because they don't change. So they're the ones who effect change by not changing themselves. Okay? And then there are those who go through drastic changes. Those are the ones who go through the hero's journey and everything else that we've heard about story and the character development so far. Alright. Coming on to the dimensions, I see characters in three dimensions for themselves. First, which occupies the maximum space in my opinion, is their personal dimension. In the sense that this is what drives all of their beliefs, their fears, what they dream of, what are their goals, their motivations. Everything that makes them do things in other dimensions comes from here. What has happened to them in the past, or what has their legacy been so far? Those are all the experiences that we talk about when we talk about the personal dimension of a character, which occupies 50% of any character in my opinion. The next is where they spend most of their time, which is the professional space. Your job, your relationship with your employer, your relationship with your fellow employees, how you are at the job, what are the skills that you have. These are the elements which shape how you are in your social circle or how you react to certain things. Say if you're frustrated in your job, that frustration is bound to carry back home with you. Right? Is everybody with
me? Yes.
All right. And if you're happy in your job, then everything else kind of starts to fall in place as it is for most people. This is also where maximum scope for turmoil is there. In the sense that there'll be somebody who'll step on you, there'll be somebody who'll backstab you, won't have a good sale in a particular month, and then that kind of causes a turmoil for your character. Then comes the final bit of the sphere, which is the social dimension, which is where your love interests, your friendships, your relationships, your notions of justice, interests, quirks, everything comes out. The person that you are when you're with your friends, when you're with your most trusted circle of most trusted people, where you have no filter whatsoever, the person that you're there. And as sad as that may be, that's only 20% of who your character and even we as people get to be. Alright, so based on this, there's another activity that I have for you today. I have given three tips to three different people here. What we'll be doing is I'll be asking them, each of them one by one, to read out what I've given them. And these are points of turmoil. Okay? There is no right or wrong answer to it, but what I want you to focus on is if you have a character in mind, for this activity, you could think of a character from a movie, or you could think of yourself as that character, or if you've been working on a character, you could take them and just think how they would react. I don't want your answers, but I want you to think about it. Alright, let's start with Dhani.
On the
movie? Yeah.
Okay, I think I'll the Robin Hood problem. Your character is an eyewitness to a crime. A man has robbed a bank, but instead of keeping the money for himself, he donates it to an orphanage that can afford to feed, clothe, and care for its children. You know who committed the crime. If you go to the authorities with the information, there's a good chance the money will be returned to the bank, leaving a lot of kids in need. What does your character do? Turn the robber in, stealing is wrong, end of story. Keep the information to yourself because the money is going to a good cause.
Thank you, Dhani. Is there anybody here who would like to share their answer? I won't force you to, but if you want to, you're welcome. What would you do? Or,
I would make my character surrender for the robbery, but I work to make sure the money doesn't go to the bank, or maybe not the whole amount.
Okay.
Probably would turn the person
in.
India. Because, you know, money stolen with that kind of path and being used for the good cause is not actually doing the good thing in reality. So, if you really want to do something good for the society or the orphanage, you should probably find another way, you know, a positive way. Because after, I mean, if you actually because in the end, the money, you know, also belongs to other 1,000 people who might be suffering again.
Yeah. All right. Is there anybody who would let it be and just let the money be where it is?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly my point. So, depending on where you're coming from, your character's response will be different. So, just think about it. What has your character gone through and what? How would they react in that situation? Let's have the next one from Sandeep.
See, trolley problem. There is a trolley running down a track. In its path are five people who have been tied to the track and can't move. Next to your character is a lever with the power to lead the trolley down a different track. Unfortunately, there is your single most loved person tied to that one. What does your character do? First one, nothing. The five people die, save your love. Second, pull the lever, saving five people but killing the love of your life.
Again, I don't want you to answer this. I just want you to think, how would your character react? Or how would you want your character to react? And we're not going to get into a discussion of this, because this is, I don't even want to get into it. But yes, it's a Sophie's choice. So you have, but your character will have to take a decision in that moment in your story. Exactly. Sanjay sir, would you like to read yours?
Sinking sensation. You have been on cruise for 2 days when there is an accident that forces everyone on board to abandon ship. During the evacuation, one of the boats is damaged, leaving it with a hole that fills in with water. You figure that with 10 people in the boat, you can keep the boat afloat by having 9 people scoop the filling water out by hand for 10 minutes while 10th person rests. After that person's 10 minute rest, he or she will get back to work while another person rests, and so on. This should keep the boat from sinking long enough for a rescue team to find you, as long as it happens within 5 hours. You are taking your first break when you notice your best friend in a second lifeboat with only 9 people in it, and he beckons you to swim over and join them so you won't have to keep bailing out water. If you leave the people in the sinking boat, they will only be able to stay afloat for 2 hours instead of 5, decreasing their chance of being rescued. But securing yours, what do you do? Number one, stay on the boat, hoping that you will all be rescued within 5 hours. Option two, jump ship, join the other boat and save your life.
Thank you, Sanjay.
Tough choice.
So this is again something that you have to think from your character's point of view. Not you, but your character. You probably haven't gone through the same experiences as your character has in the story that you're writing. What would your character do in that situation? Everybody with me so far? Alright, so let's get to the writing bit of it. I've divided this section into 3 parts. First bit is the homework, the things that you have to do before you can even begin writing a character. So, there are 3 ways of how I've seen people who've written stories kind of deal with this kind of a situation. First is they develop a questionnaire for themselves based on what they want to write about the character. And then they'll fill that questionnaire out. That could contain all of these things. Like your height, your name, your age, your gender, what is your build, what is your relationship status, where do you live, basically they give you the character and life through that questionnaire. The other thing that people do is sketch out an internal monologue. So this activity is kind of creative. You go out in a public place, find a place to sit, and then just pick one person walking around and just observe them, focus on them, and write what they're thinking in first person. So say, I think I'm feeling thirsty, let me go get a coffee, if you see them walk into a coffee shop. Or if you see them looking at the time, where is this friend of mine and I've been waiting for him for so long. Alright, so just internalize their monologue and then use that as a character. This has the potential of helping you note down some quirks. In the sense that if people are nervous, what do? I fidget. There are a lot of people who scratch themselves. There are a lot of people who just start playing with their phone. So there are different traits that people have. And then again, those traits are also things that have a past and a way that it's expressed. So say nervousness, it must have some past. That why is it that this person is so nervous about something so trivial as somebody getting late? Maybe there are people that they've lost in accidents and they're just scared that the same thing happened to this person. And then how does it manifest? So those are the kind of things that you can note down as you observe. And the third is a timeline. So instead of just thinking about a character in the present, you draw up a timeline for them. Say, I am 23 years old. What happened to me when I was 2 years old? What happened to me when I was 5 years old? 7, 10, 15, 13, whatever, a timeline. And then pick out 5 or 7 of the most relevant of those times, which kind of shaped how I think, how I behave in the present. And then use those to develop your character. Okay. Moving on to the fun bit, which is when you are delivering a speech, you not only need to describe the character, but you also need to be the character. And while you can do a lot with body language and words, voice is something that a lot of people forget and kind of struggle with. As far as characters go, again, say if you're delivering a dialogue as a king, it need not be a caricature, it need not be, oh, I am the king. It could be something as simple as, I am the king. Just that loudness does it for you. It does not need to be a caricature. Right? So that's again something that you have to focus on. And when you're delivering the character, focus less on the physical attributes and more on ideologies and how people behave. Alright, the final bit that I have for you today is actually on how to meet the characters unforgettable. Now, the best characters that I have seen or that I remember are all of those who have several layers to them instead of just a name. So those are the layers that I kind of think about when I start writing a character. First layer is just physical. That's how I would use that. That's what I say in the first sentence when I describe a character. Tall, handsome. Second is when I get to the quirks or the vulnerabilities. I put either one of them. Say, always running around people to get them to do things. That is the thing I'd want people to remember about this person. That is the thing that'd be key to my story. Third is the interactions, dislikes. That's again a little bit basic, but then that's a third layer because that's not really essential to my story, but I still want to put it out there for people to kind of relate to that character more. And the final is the point that will make your character unforgettable, and that is when the character breaks their identity. That is when, because of their emotions and because of whatever they've gone through in the past, they do something which they are not likely to do. So that's how I would make a character unforgettable, and I hope that was helpful. I had an activity planned, but that's something we'll do a little bit later. So, out of time. With that, let's welcome back on stage our host for the day, Toastmaster Mukesh Thakur.